I'm Michael Williams. I'm the director of the Wheeler Centre, and it's lovely to see, I can't see anyone, but I trust that you're here in the room in front of me at the Athenaeum for tonight's very special evening. A couple of days ago at the Festival of Dangerous Ideas at the Sydney Opera House, Australia's favourite columnist, Andrew Bolt, took the moderator to task for their acknowledgement of country. He said it was divisive and insulting and discriminatory. We're on the land of the Wurundjeri people. This is the Kulin Nation, and we pay our respects to elders past and present, not to be divisive, not to be discriminatory, but to remember, because we have a responsibility to remember. Acknowledgement of country is about acknowledging that the moral and legal implication of invasion remains unresolved to this day, and we do so tonight. I do have some really fantastic news, which is apparently there's never been a more exciting time to be Australian, which is a relief. We're in the 45th Parliament and it looks to be a doozy. And there's endless commentary, there's endless commentariat, people sitting around talking and navel-gazing and trying to understand it. But two of the clearest voices through all of that, two of our wisest voices, our funniest voices, our most insightful voices are joining us on the stage tonight to talk about power and personality and Australian politics in the 45th Parliament. They've both had the experience of writing about politicians moments before they go into a decline. But the beauty... the beauty of the 45th Parliament of Australia is we don't know which one's going into a decline, and it's going to be great to watch. Please join me in welcoming to the stage Annabel Crabb and David Marr.
Now, we've agreed that I'm going to start because normally he just jumps in. And now I've completely thwarted you, which means this is a great night for me already. Now,
keep an eye on the next hour. Keep an eye on how much time she lets me have.
I come from the ABC. We're very balanced about these things.
If there's a sense out there that I'm not getting a fair shake, will somebody speak up for me, please?
Yeah. Oh, your addled fans will be all over it, I'm sure. Now, 6 months ago, you and I were in a similarly awful situation, which is to say, lamentably behind on a deadline. I speak for myself mainly there because you were sort of on time to write a book-length account of a person who, after the looming election, would be the Prime Minister. And to add to the degree of difficulty, because it's really awkward to write a book about somebody, you know, a biographical sort of profile of somebody who's about to be the Prime Minister, because you've got to pick so many things. One, the way the election will probably go. Two, the way that person will respond to events. And three, in a way that makes you not look like a fool when the inevitable mess occurs, right? And of course, for both of us, we've killed before when writing about political leaders, which is that dreadful thing that happens when you publish a book about somebody and 2 weeks later they stop being the leader of their party. Now, that had happened to me with Kevin Rudd, Rise of the Ruddbot 2009, about a week after that book came out, I think.
I had 3 weeks of my quarterly essay on Kevin Rudd before he was knocked off. I was in London and I got a phone call from Fran Kelly saying, "It's a good thing your book sold well early." and I said, "Why? What's happened? Is there a defamation problem?" And she said, "No, he's in there now being sacked."
Fran is always first with the news. It's good to get it from a friendly informant. I had published a quarterly essay about Malcolm.
All those years ago?
I think a month or two before he met his end as leader of the opposition. So collectively we had shed some blood, I think, as
biographers. It is the problem with writing little books on the go, on the run. And, I mean, my view is that as newspapers lose the capacity to carry long-form journalism, that little books on contemporary issues are the way of the future. But we run the risk that events can shift and change underneath us. And my first version of the Shorten essay was being trucked to the shops the afternoon Turnbull overthrew Abbott. And a large theme of my first version of the Shorten essay was that this was a contest of lesser men. It all suddenly changed. I was proud of how little needed to be changed for the next version.
It's amazing how a couple of little tweaks can really change the face of a piece of business like that. The other tricky thing that we've for each faced 6 months ago is that we'd each written already about our subjects. I'd written a quarterly essay about Malcolm Turnbull in 2009.
Coming back again is hard.
You'd written one more recently about Bill Shorten. So tell me what your experience was like of writing about somebody whose field you'd already ploughed.
Well,
awkward? Not awkward?
Well, when I started to write about Shorten, it has to be said that the general public attitude towards Shorten was that he was a time server, he really shouldn't have been there, he wasn't going to last long, and he was going to do a deplorable job of being leader of the opposition. Now, I looked at Shorten.
That's a pretty good review, given like the last 10 years, really.
I started to investigate this man, and I started to talk to people and look at his record and work out how it was that he'd climbed so incredibly swiftly. 20 years from being an organiser in the AWU to the leader of the opposition is a very swift rise. And I discovered that he may not be the most interesting man in the world, and he isn't, but he's an astonishingly professional politician. And as one of his opponents in the Labour Party said to me as I was preparing the quarterly essay, the thing is, he doesn't make mistakes. I was in a really difficult position, which was, here is a person who is widely sort of dismissed as a non-starter. And I'm writing an essay saying, actually, he's a professional and he's got big prospects. And it's an uncomfortable position because it makes you sound like a spruiker for him. And I was not a spruiker for him. But I was trying to draw people's attention to the fact that there were, you know, reserves of talent there and achievements there that had not been really seen. I mean, he's much more known in Victoria. Victoria is such a strange political territory in this country. I mean, people think the Northern Territory is strange politics, but Victoria is the strangest politics of them all. I mean, the factional madness of Victoria is unbelievably difficult for outsiders to grasp. And I was very, very pleased when my editor read my chapter on the faction system of Victoria, and he said it reads like a wildlife documentary. but all of this was happening, and then bang, the terms of the contest changed. Abbott had gone, and Turnbull was in his place. And what an execution that was! What a defenestration that was! It was in many ways the most. Wouldn't you agree the best footwork that Malcolm Turnbull has shown in the last 18 months was the disposal of Tony Abbott?
Yes, yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah, he did it extraordinarily well. And then, different contestants for the election. And Black Ink, our publishers, are a pretty grubby lot. And they look to commercial advantage at all times. And they saw the commercial advantage of getting her rewrite her Malcolm Turnbull essay and me rewrite my Shorten essay. And we agreed to it. I thought we'd agreed that it would come out in a slipcase, in a little, you know, in a little sort of companion. Anyway. The deadline was early January.
That's
and
true.
I rewrote for early January. And in early January of this year, Shorten looked a goner. She failed to meet her deadline because she has so many other professional responsibilities and three children, which take some of her time. And I'm very, very glad that the new deadline, which I think was March...
I saved your ass.
Because between January, when there were actually moves to get rid of Shorten, and March, he had reasserted his dominance of the Labour Party and had reasserted the strategy that was going to take the Labour Party very, very close in the election. And I was very pleased to be able to write the version that I was able to write, once again saying, this man is a formidable politician. And you had a chance to write about Malcolm Turnbull.
As Prime Minister.
But you also had a chance to write about that phenomenal outburst of public adulation that then drifted away.
This is an extraordinary aspect of Malcolm Turnbull's life, and I'm kind of rethinking him every day as events unfold. And this is why you've written about some very fascinating people. You've written about Bill Shorten, who's hard to write about because he doesn't have that same Tony Abbott-style barn door bizarreness that just compels you to get in there and rootle around a bit because everything is just so interesting, including, you know, priesthood, had a kid, didn't have a kid. Oh, God, it's just... It's like The Young and the Restless, you know. Yeah. I'm not saying it's an easy life to write about, but gosh, fun.
And Malcolm's life, of course, lived in public.
Right.
He's extraordinary. I mean, everything was lived in public. His career, whereas Shorten's, behind closed doors.
Certainly. So Turnbull, and when I started writing about him in 2009, I couldn't believe that no one had written a biography of him. Now, Paddy Manning has now written a biography of him, like a full proper length one, which is a great book.
Which is terrific because it really gets into the business
stuff.
If you want to know about Malcolm Turnbull, the businessman, Paddy's book's wonderful.
Like the
detail.
Wood plantations in PNG. What? Oh my God.
The gold exploration in Siberia.
I mean, this is a person who's lived some very weird lives, you know, and started with this Dickensian beginning, you know. Some of the most interesting politicians have these childhoods of privation or trauma that equip
tragedy
them throughout life with this almost like a skin of impermeability or that is paired with a vulnerability and a need to do well, to perform for someone. There's a great book called The Fiery Chariot, British Prime Ministers and Their Search for Love, which was written in the 1970s by a woman called Lucille Eyermonger. I mean,
it's a great book.
It's so
weird and fascinating.
So she goes through this sort of dozens of British Prime Ministers
British
and identifies that just a disproportionate number of them had lost a parent in early life. And
usually the father.
Often the father.
So the mothers are the ones who drive most political careers. It is kind of true of Malcolm Turnbull because the mother is absent, but she's driving him. But I blame mothers for most of the pathology. Most of
we could be here all night on this one.
Of power in this country, it's the mother. I mean, you know, Kevin Rudd's father died tragically after a day of drinking at the Masonic Hall in Brisbane. He was a dairy farmer. He had to get home to milk, and he hit a tree on the way, which is terrible. But you know, the absent and Malcolm, of course, a different story altogether. His mother was a bolter.
Took the furniture,
which is remarkable. You take the furniture, but you leave the child. Mm. My brother-in-law remembers Malcolm as a little boy. They were together at boarding school. He remembers the misery of this child. And he remembers that every now and again a tape recording would arrive from his mother, who by this time had gone to New Zealand, wasn't it?
She went to New Zealand with her new bloke, who was an academic, and then they both moved to Philadelphia, and then he left her for another woman, and she kind of buzzed back and forth between Australia and Philadelphia after that, and she died in Philadelphia, whereupon Malcolm flew there and gathered every last possession of hers and shipped them all home and put them in the farm that he had bought, that he'd taken over after his father died in a light plane accident. He'd kept all of his father's stuff, boots, hat, watch that he wore for years, and he put all of their things together in this country house, which is still there in Scone. We did a kitchen cabinet there. And I walked around that house and he showed me around and it was the most extraordinary thing. all of her books, all of his stuff, photographs of the three of them together. And the thing that really made me well up was that in the hall, there's a little hall stand that had been in her flat in Philadelphia, and inside a little tiny drawer was the tokens that she had never used on the Philadelphia trolley car. You know, he hadn't thrown away anything. A strange thing for a child to, in adulthood, reunite as parents in that way, in a way that they never were, you know, when he was alive. Anyway, I'm being maudlin about it, but the things that happen to people in their childhood do have a great effect on the way they are as political leaders. Kevin Rudd, for instance, when he was, during that strange and turbulent time when he was Prime Minister, the themes to which he would return and the things that would affect him on a deep level were those themes that he identified with his own childhood: homelessness, the apology, separation of children from parents, organ donation, because he was the recipient of a donor heart valve. People who become politicians, and particularly who become political leaders, are sculpted by circumstance beyond recognition. Experience encrusts them with scar tissue. You know, their brains don't last forever because they tip one way or the other. Either they're too vulnerable to continue, they're too susceptible to the judgments of those around them, to the slings and arrows that they experience, or the scar tissue gets too thick and they are unable to listen to people around them, and they grow crazy in their offices and they brick themselves in like Tony Abbott. The idea is, as Malcolm actually said on that kitchen cabinet that we did, to get to the midway, you know, through those two perilous goalposts, you know, you've got to hit the middle where you still are able to listen. You're not so crazy that you stop listening, but you also maintain a strength of purpose that drives you forward and allows you to identify a direction, right?
I think I can speak for both of us here and speak over Annabel as I do, that we would both have the hope that writing about politicians' lives is not just smutty curiosity, because
although there is that,
well, there can be that, and you know, in some lives more than others. But everybody, I think, is interested when they and kind of vitally interested when they look at political candidates to ask themselves, why does this person want power, and what is he or she going to be like?
What would this person not give up? What would this person die in a ditch for?
What are the person's principles? What will they die in a ditch for? What will they give away? What will they negotiate away? But the subject of character in politics is not necessarily the meat and drink of week by week commentary, but it is what books are for. It is what short books and long books are for. The character of our politicians. We've got an economy, we've got a geography, we've got a climate, we've got, you know, international events, but at the heart of it all is a man or a woman leading this country, and we want to know what they're like. I think Australians are pretty good judges of political character. Mark Latham was an example. There was a very strong wish. People were tired of John Howard. And Latham came along, and he was aggressive and barnstorming and a big character. And rather like Turnbull, there was this huge wave of support for him, a wave of support which had one, for politicians, unhappy outcome. One of the things he was on about was reducing the privileged superannuation scheme of parliamentarians. And Howard gave way on that. And Without a flicker of hesitation, he sold the young parliamentarians up the river. But Australians looked at Latham over those months, and by the time the election came, they'd got that man in their sights, and they didn't trust him. They didn't elect him. Now, Kevin Rudd was another one. Again, people by this time were completely tired of John Howard. even though John Howard is, I think, in my estimation, the most professional politician any of us will see in our lifetime, I disliked a great deal of what he did, but his professionalism was total. They were sick of him. Rudd came along and there was this outburst of relief that there was a candidate here that was going to take over from John Howard. And Australia fell in love with Kevin Rudd, absolutely fell in love with Kevin Rudd. And when they fell out of love with him in 2010, Australians have never regained the regard for politicians that they had at that time. There's been very, very good work done on this, and you can see this kind of adoration of Rudd, and it falls off a cliff. And from that point onwards, there has been in the Australian community a lower view of political leaders. And mind you, there's been good evidence that, you know, we have not had a great leader since then, it has to be said. Gillard, immensely skilled. I mean, her management of a minority parliament is looking pretty good in contrast to last week.
You know, what Australians look for, I think, I mean, this is just an observer's view, is ideology and competence. You know, these things
what
are in...
What do you mean by ideology?
Well, you have to have a defining principle.
I don't think we much like ideologues.
Come on, you've had plenty of chats. I'm just...
I'm helping her.
You have to know... Ideology is like the banner that you carry, right?
Principles.
You want to know what this person wants to do. And then you want to know that they're going to be
competent
in prosecuting that approach. That allows you sometimes to even vote for them if you don't necessarily support the banner, right? Which I suspect is actually the key to John Howard's length of term in office.
I agree.
Because his competency and the fact that you kind of knew what it said on the tin at all times, right? There was very little surprising that guy did. You knew what he wanted to do, and he did it at every opportunity where he had a chance, you know, like when the Senate permitted or whatever. Whereas one of the difficult things about ensuing governments, I think, is that what it said on the tin wasn't necessarily always quite so clear. So someone who's ideological and incompetent, like Tony Abbott, for instance, is a confusing proposition because you know kind of what they want to do and you kind of think, well, what we'll end up with is probably a bit different, and the space between those two propositions is the scary thing, right? The other problem is when you have someone where, you know, the stuff they're trying to do is not necessarily the stuff that you identify them with. And I think that that's the problem that Malcolm Turnbull has right now. And I think it's actually a problem that Julia Gillard had over the course of her leadership as well.
Does Malcolm even have a tin? To have a label?
Look, he's got a tin, I think. And it's not a traditional liberal ideological tin. And that is why the Liberal Party has spent a whole lot of time trying to chuck that tin out before it even got to us, right? You know, he has been the creature that has been viewed by the most suspicion by the Liberal Party even before he became its leader. Mm. The way he smashed his way into pre-selection for that seat of Wentworth, which is just the most visually amusing and least orthodox ways of getting pre-selection for
money
the Liberal
counted.
Party. Precisely. And he approached that task the way that you would if you were in mergers and acquisitions. He went in through the front door with a couple of giant pine logs and several hundred thousand dollars worth of subscription fees to the Liberal Party. And it was brilliant to watch. It was a great thing for a journalist because most of this stuff happens behind closed doors, but not for Malcolm Turnbull, who just bought, you know...
Shorten does that kind of thing brilliantly behind closed doors.
Yeah. Right. So that filled them all with terror, you know. Imagine this guy who is one of the most notorious and widely feared commercial operators, businessmen, merchant bankers and lawyers in Sydney. You know, he's notorious in 2004. Everybody has a Malcolm Turnbull story. There are the ones that he ritually sues over, like the one about him killing his girlfriend's cat, which is, I questioned him about when I was writing this essay about him, and I was very nervous because I thought he'd sued every time it was mentioned up till now. I thought, it's time to get to the bottom of this. I'm just going to ask him about the cat at the end of the interview, of course. And of course, he had, I think, prepared himself to answer this question.
Oh, the great line.
No cat has died at my hands.
Yes!
Yeah. Anyway, so he wins the seat in 2004. I do go into the cat story in quite a bit of detail in the book, and my conclusion
is sweet to leave my role in it out.
Is that, yes. Yeah, you're involved. He's heavily involved. I don't think that a jury today would convict because the evidence is largely circumstantial, but I don't necessarily
or non-existent.
Rule out. Yeah,
yes.
Slash non-existent. Mm. Yes. Anyway, so forget cat killing. He was of absolute deep threat to the Liberal Party room when he turns up in 2004. And in absolute copybook Malcolm Turnbull fashion, I mean, this is the guy who stared down the Thatcher government over the spycatcher case. This is the guy who was Kerry Packer's widely feared right-hand bother boy of the law, who showed no fear in his dealings with everybody on Packer's behalf, including during the Costigan inquiry, and who then went on to a fearsome career in merchant banking. He turned up at the Liberal Party room and immediately designed a new tax system for Australia and handed it to Peter Costello, who was thrilled to receive this series of suggestions from the lowest profile backbencher. Anyway, so you start to get the idea of why the Liberal Party is kind of suspicious of Malcolm Turnbull. He shows up in 2004, you know, he's best mates with Neville Wran, he's good mates with Bob Carr, he knows Keating socially, you know. These are all things that are not cool in that particular milieu, right? And then in 2007, when he's been actually quite judiciously promoted by John Howard, who has the most deep-seated, dirty sense of humour about these sorts of things and loves setting off people against each other. I mean, this is the guy who made George Brandis sports minister, which is possibly the greatest joke in the history.
Joke.
It is. Yes. It's brilliant. Yeah. See, people don't understand that about Howard. Yeah. He's got an excellent sense of humour. And so tactically promoting Malcolm Turnbull right at the point where he was most annoying Peter Costello was actually quite an elegant manoeuvre, I think. Anyway, so we get to the 2007 election. Howard gets turfed out, the most humiliating defeat in history since Stanley Bruce. He loses not only government but his own seat, and he's heading across the bridge from Kirribilli to make his dolorous concession speech at the Wentworth Hotel.
His career in ruins.
Sackcloth, ashes, everywhere ashes. And his phone rings and it's Malcolm Turnbull who says, John, great news, I've increased my majority. So that's the guy we're dealing with, right? It's just no sense of occasion or...
But what's...
And everybody in the Liberal Party room thinks, dear God, at some point that guy is going to be the leader of our party. You can't kill him. You can't stop him. I mean, he betrayed Kerry Packer in the end. He'll hand anyone over. He will be our ruler and we just don't know what he's going to be like. And they responded to the 2007 election by, I mean, putting this fabulous sort of, you know, mattress in the doorway by electing Brendan Nelson to the leadership. An event to which an incredulous Malcolm Turnbull responded by just storming into Brendan Nelson's office and saying, oh, it's ridiculous, you're pathetic. You're going to have to quit. Sorry, I keep...
But the pattern that Annabel is talking about here is part of the explanation of the turmoil of Australian politics in the last 6 years. Mm. We are going through a notoriously bad patch in this country. We have had how many prime ministers?
Six.
And one of the reasons is that their parties haven't liked them. Kevin Rudd, loathed by everybody who had actually worked with him and loved by the public, loathed by his own party. And one of the reasons for his such swift downfall was they never understood the public's affection for this man. They never understood why.
It was like a 50-yard rule, wasn't it?
It was a 50-yard rule. You know that terrible expression that fade on approach? You say of people, FOA, from a distance they look so beautiful, but they fade on approach.
Which is interesting because Julia Gillard was exactly the opposite.
And Gillard was exactly the opposite. But here was Labor electing, or here was Labor electing a leader who, if you were close to him, you really, really distrusted and disliked him, and he was got rid of. This was not true of Gillard, because the closer you got to Gillard, the more in awe you were of her, and the more you liked her, if you're a Labor person. And then the Liberal Party elects Brendan Nelson, which is sweet. But that was after one of the most astonishing moments in recent Australian history. Do you remember the moment, the morning after Howard's defeat, when Costello appeared with his wife at the microphone? I was in Brisbane and I'd gone up there to hear Rudd's victory speech, one of the weirdest speeches I've ever heard in my life. As I later said, it was as if he was, you know, as if he'd won the lottery and he was telling the party that he wasn't going to shout the bar. But the next morning there was Costello with his wife, and I shouted in this room of journalists, he's going to resign. And they, yeah! But the wife, he resigned. So then they elected Brendan, which was cute. And then Turnbull, and they didn't like Turnbull. Turnbull was not a natural Liberal. And then they had as their leader Tony Abbott, who they all regarded as DLP. He was a DLP-er. And I found the fact that he was a DLP-er fascinating. And in fact, my quarterly essay is rather a hymn to the possibilities of a DLP-er running the coalition government, because there are some actually quite attractive...
Subject's shell-like ears were pretty slammed shut.
It didn't work out that way. He turned out to be a completely ordinary and rather extreme coalition leader. And then we get Turnbull back again. Again, they don't like and trust him.
No, and that's why they trussed him up like a chicken on the day after he won the leadership.
And then Shorten is somebody who, not trusted much by the public when he was made leader of the opposition, was quite deeply trusted by the Labor Party. I mean, Labor Party doesn't trust anybody, of course, but in terms of his control of and his quietening of the Labor Party is quieter now, less torn by inner conflict than it's been in a generation. And that's Shorten. He has this extraordinary ability to take broken and fractious institutions. He did it first with the AWU, and then he did it with the Labor Party. The Labor Party defeat in 2013 was one of the worst defeats in the history of the Labor Party, and he nearly took it to victory this year. He has that remarkable ability, but the question with Shorten always is, what is the price of his compromises? It's exactly the same question that faces Turnbull. What's the price of his compromises? And Shorten's enemies within the Labor Party ask a wonderful question of him, which can also be asked of Turnbull. They say about him in his negotiations, does he settle soft? It's Labor. It's a union question. Does he settle soft? And the view of Shorten, a lot of people inside the Labor Party, is that he settles soft. But my view of Turnbull in taking the leadership and agreeing to the things that the National Party demanded of him was that at that moment he settled soft. And that's the problem that Turnbull has.
Isn't it interesting that in Bill Shorten you have one of the great internal sceptics on climate change, going back maybe 10 years.
Yep.
And not one of the great champions of marriage equality, I think it's fair to say.
No.
Who, in this past election, has campaigned strongly on both of those things, and yet in Malcolm Turnbull, you have someone who is the most senior internal advocate within the Liberal National Party coalition of marriage equality, and the person who has gambled most on pricing carbon in that political outfit and lost everything once has also been the architect of the closest thing to consensus that our major parties have reached over the last 10 years on that huge issue of climate change. Powerless on both of those fronts right now.
And you've got to reflect, haven't you, what a magnificent politician Kevin Rudd was. As he was trying to nail down an alliance with Malcolm Turnbull as leader of the opposition back then on climate change, the biggest challenge facing the country, and simultaneously kicking the shit out of Malcolm Turnbull as leader of the opposition. It was good, wasn't it?
Well, that's political opportunism, right? And that is one of the endemic problems of our system right now, which is that our system now doesn't know how to recognise consensus even when it exists.
Staring them in the face. But you're unfair to Shorten. Yes, Shorten took time to come to the understanding of the importance of climate change, but he is a very important Labor leader in terms of his attitudes to marriage. Very important. Remember, Gillard, who, if I can say it in this company, because it's Melbourne and they understand expressions like this, was living in sin. Gillard opposed equal marriage. Presumably, we believe, as part of a deal with the Shop Assistance Union for their support. She opposed equal marriage. Now, Shorten's life story, and here is where, again, the biography and the character are incredibly important. Shorten's first marriage failed. His second marriage brought with him two kids from an earlier marriage. He lives in a blended family. A few years ago, and in his first marriage, there were, sadly, failed attempts to have kids from IVF. Now, all of that was a violation of his Catholic childhood, his Catholic beliefs. And he grew through that, and he learnt through that. And a few years ago, he went to the Christian lobby and delivered a speech that no Labor leader has ever delivered to the Australian Christian lobby, that bunch of bastards. And I'm being even-handed when I say that. And Shorten gave it to them. He gave it to them. And he told them that he wasn't going to be a Labor leader that sided with them against blended families, against IVF, against homosexuals. And he is the first Labor leader to go out there and really spruik for equal marriage. Now this, from a grey man who came out of the union movement, I welcome it myself. But this is another example of the power of life story and of character in the evolution of politics in this country. And Shorten embodies that rather unexpectedly, but he does.
It's interesting, isn't it? Because I think that Malcolm Turnbull has relished throughout his business and legal and to some extent political life triumphing over ill will.
Winning them over.
Well, smashing through it.
Yes. Beating them.
Finding opponents who despise him on a gut level and just punishing them. I think the interesting thing about him, and this is a bit of a contrast, I think, with Shorten, is that when he did finally ascend to the leadership, when he did finally knock over Tony Abbott from the prime ministership and the nation went into this weird post-coital cigarette phase of, you know, we did a poll on ABC Online And it asked respondents to choose the word that best represented their mood at that moment. And relief was the most popular term by a country mile, just daylight second. It was the most extraordinary sort of graph representation. The interesting thing about Malcolm Turnbull is that I think he's not coped as well with goodwill as he has throughout his entire career with ill will. And it's interesting because I think most politicians at some level like to be liked, you know, and
they're in it to be loved.
Shorten is a great love sponge, you know. He does like to be liked. And so does Turnbull, but I don't think he's really managed to capitalise on the great goodwill that was at his disposal just a year ago. If you can think of the way that he's transacted having the goodwill even of a bunch of state premiers, not all of them even Liberal state premiers. I mean, he had a huge amount of support from Mike Baird, some very, I think, courageous political support from Jay Weatherill in South Australia, both of whom were angling for and prepared to go out there and make the running for changes to the GST, all of which were changes that Turnbull and Morrison sort of considered over the early months of the Turnbull government and then sort of spectacularly discarded in a sort of gangle of limbs just about the time that you were finalising your manuscript about Bill Shorten. It's a funny circumstance, isn't it, watching a politician being unable to cope with great potential and having a huge amount of political capital.
It's to look back and here is the nation falling at Malcolm Turnbull's feet and he says, no, I'll have the election next year. I mean, that's just, in retrospect, it's just unbelievable. Mm. On the day he beat Abbott, and this is the sentence I used to open the updated version of the Shorten essay, Shorten said to a friend, I'm cactus, aren't I? I'm cactus. That friend had some good advice, which I have there. But he would have been if Turnbull had moved at that point. I want to ask you a question about Turnbull. We're going to throw to you for questions in a moment. But what do you make of Turnbull's strange search for fathers in his career? I'm fascinated by it. I don't understand it.
Well, there is a line of argument which goes that he is at his best when he is under the supervision of a father-like figure. I mean, he was at his most ruthless and effective as a tactician for Kerry Packer.
Yeah.
And he relied, I think, similarly on Neville Wran as a sort of a guiding force. His own father died in a light plane accident when he was in his mid-20s. It was a terrible shock to him. He struggled in a very deep way to get over this latest of afflictions that life had inflicted upon him. He responded in quite a grown-up way. You know, he took over his father's farm at great expense and difficulty, buried his father on the farm and then proceeded. But he's been the consigliere, I suppose, to a bunch of powerful, sometimes crazy men.
Was Howard another one of the fathers?
Oh, God, yeah, absolutely. Yeah. You see, the perception about Malcolm Turnbull and John Howard is that they were great enemies, right? And that the night of the vote on the referendum, Malcolm made some remarks about how John Howard had broken this nation's heart and so on. And people assumed then, I think, that the two of them were just these enemies. And that's not true. I mean, Howard, as I mentioned earlier, was the person who promoted this difficult backbencher to be his own personal advisor on water policy. And water policy is one of the great obsessions of Malcolm Turnbull's life. When his father died and he took over the farm, he spent this intense period of grieving, learning all about the water table on the property and the irrigation and fixing it all up. I mean, to this day, he will give you a two-hour lecture on Roman aqueducts and irrigation. I mean, you really will glaze over, but he knows this stuff. I mean, he really is obsessed with it. And in my similarly obsessive way, I'm really fascinated with the parallels between him and our second Prime Minister, Alfred Deakin, who also was so obsessed with water management that he went and lived in California for a while and wrote a book about Southeast Asian irrigation. I could bore you for a while on this stuff too. I won't. Back to Howard. Howard promoted Malcolm Turnbull then to be the Environment Minister, gave him carriage of sorting out water management issues in Australia, and was ultimately convinced by Malcolm Turnbull to adopt a carbon emission pricing scheme to take to the 2007 election, which is something we also forget. I mean, yeah. both parties in this country went to the election in 2007 offering an emissions trading scheme. It is a part of that sickening carousel of climate policy that we are the tragic veterans of in this country, that we generally forget that that was the case, but it was. And then when Malcolm Turnbull, having been just spectacularly punted from the leadership of the Liberal Party in 2009. Again, this is something that's passed into our history, so we don't appreciate, as we may have on the day that it happened, the incredible randomness of this event. I mean, Malcolm Turnbull, having made a handshake deal with Kevin Rudd and Penny Wong on carbon pricing, got it through his shadow cabinet, took it to his party room. They had a day-long debate, which was really characterised by his former climate spokesman, Andrew Robb's decision, he was then on mental health leave, to turn up and make a scorching speech, completely by surprise, excoriating the deal that Malcolm Turnbull had made with Kevin Rudd. That swung enough votes in the party room to throw that deal out, and thus Malcolm Turnbull himself, when the subsequent leadership vote happened, through some incredible, what I can only call really a clusterfuck of biblical proportions.
We call it a cluster now.
Oh,
the word fuck has been dropped.
Oh, okay.
And it's in the press now, you see the expression a major cluster.
I know,
cluster.
I saw that. I just thought this audience is probably adult enough.
You don't need to say fuck,
Annabel. You can also say fuster cluck. I used that in the paper a month or two ago. I apologise to anyone who was offended. But in the ensuing melee, as you will recall, the two pro-carbon pricing candidates for the leadership of the Liberal Party, Joe Hockey and Malcolm Turnbull, both comically stood, even though they weren't expecting the other to stand, cancelled each other out. And the surprised beneficiary of this piece of incompetence was one Tony Abbott, who sailed through by one vote. One vote to become the leader of the Liberal Party and ultimately the Prime Minister.
I was there outside the party room that afternoon, and when the members of the MPs were walking away from the party room, I heard one National Party senator say to another National Party senator of Tony Abbott, "Even my mother won't vote for him."
He was wrong.
But when
Malcolm Turnbull tried to quit after that, who talked him out of quitting? Who went round and
said,
"Stick around"?
John Howard said, "Stick around." It seems to me that one of the things that was at the heart of the national euphoria when Tony Abbott went out the window and Turnbull took over is a notion that finally there could be closure on some of these issues. That one of the things we underestimate is the boredom of Australia with the fact that we just can't seem to ever fix things in this country, that it takes so long, that the work is so hard, that it never gets done. And when Turnbull became leader that afternoon, it did seem for a moment that we would finally see something reasonable done on climate change and the equal marriage argument and a range of other things where the nature of Australian politics, and it's something I become more and more interested in, is designed to stop the future. Mm-hmm. This country is about stopping the future, the politics of this country. And
well, it's about 226 people running around in that building trying to stop anything from happening.
Stopping.
Even when they all agree that it should happen.
Yes. Or even when the Australian people show, either in polling or, you know, some other way, an unchanging wish that something happen. And it doesn't happen. It never happens. And I think one of the reasons why there is, to my mind, and I'm not joking, a distressing falling away of respect for the political system in this country, is that it simply can't deliver results at the moment. And that is, I think, the biggest political challenge in this country. Fixing the budget is only one of the things that has to be done. Nothing happens. And for a brief few afternoons there, it looked as though Malcolm would be the agent of closure. And change.
Look, I think you're harsh, because some things do happen.
Yes.
And I'll give you an example of the way political orthodoxies can change in a second. Look at the NDIS, right? For many, many years, disabled people in this country
Bill
were
Shorten.
A silent...
We're talking Shorten.
I know, I'm getting
no,
there.
No, good. Right.
The orthodoxy was, you can't fix anything that unfixable. These people are not politically significant. They weren't political footballs, they were political a million miles from the stadium. And the way that that happened, and this is why personality is an incredibly influential part of the way policy gets made in this country, it happened like this. Kevin Rudd, who as Prime Minister feared and disliked the idea that people who were more powerful or more appealing some way than him would become senior, made a habit of assigning portfolios to people he viewed as a risk that would ensure that they didn't remain a risk. So he did terrible things to Peter Garrett, for instance. Mm. Bill Shorten, he gave as a poison chalice the gift of being the Parliamentary Secretary for Disability Services. Now, Bill Shorten, who was disappointed with this role, could have used that as an opportunity to become embittered and do nothing about that portfolio area, but he made a decision to prosper in that area and make that a big job.
Yep.
And that is a great thing that he did, I think. Not unaided. He was very, very significantly assisted by Jenny Macklin, who was the real power in the cabinet behind developing the disability insurance scheme. But there is no doubt that Bill Shorten's psychological response to that job has a lot to do with the way that...
He was going to show him.
Yeah, the way that issue was... then thought of in politics. It went from being a non-issue to being an issue, and then within a heartbeat of time, the coalition joined and accepted that that would be this new way forward. And that is an example of change happening really in political terms very quickly. And I think of it as an inspiring and reassuring demonstration that change on seemingly intractable problems is not impossible. What it relies upon is people, politicians, responding in a way that orthodox politics doesn't dictate that they respond. We see an enormous amount of both government and opposition political tactics where parties respond in the way that they're supposed to. If you're an opposition, you absolutely shoot down whatever the government's doing, even if it's something that you agree on. And in recent weeks, we've seen Tony Abbott reflecting on the Malaysia solution, which he now thinks is probably a good idea, and perhaps he should have voted for Malaysia.
Remember them weeping in Parliament that afternoon? Remember Hockey weeping about the horrors of sending refugees to Malaysia? So they sent them to Nauru instead. I love them.
One of the tragedies of contemporary politics is the incapability of the system to agree even when it does agree. You know, that is a real problem, you know. Anyway, we have really minutes left.
We haven't beaten people into a pulp by the magnificence of our analysis up there.
Annabel, love you to pieces, but I have to disagree about the NBN.
I haven't mentioned the NBN.
Oh, sorry, not the NBN.
Please, let's get our alphabet right.
Yes. Acronym. Yes, the NDIS. I want to compare it to what Whitlam did in 3 years rolling out Medibank at the time. Mm-hmm. In 3 years, we've been waiting 8 or 9 years for that. So I think in terms of getting something done, I don't think that's a good example.
Okay. We're using it as an example of the way political attitudes change really quickly. I think that actually equal marriage is another really good example.
Except
of
that
how...
we haven't got it.
No. Oh, people with your details. it's a really good example of how politicians, I think, left to themselves in the world of political orthodoxy. And let's not pretend that politics isn't like a sort of... It's like a sort of sport or a science where the practitioners are constantly checking each other about what is and isn't possible.
Yeah.
And that's why, I mean, and it's especially so, I'm afraid, in this age of extreme research where people arm themselves with research and won't express an opinion until they've suitably... armed themselves with that knowledge of, you know, if theoretically I said X, what would people think? There is a tendency, I think, for political parties to reassure each other and reinforce each other on no-go issues. I think that NDIS is an example of the political orthodoxy of what is and isn't a political issue and what is and isn't intractable changed very quickly. I think that same-sex marriage is another one where the community led and politics followed in an incredibly ungainly and messy fashion. We still see that mess before us today. But that change in what is considered political orthodoxy has taken place over a fairly short time, I think.
Now, inquiring minds in the circle?
I was interested in your comment about the... quieting effect that Bill Shorten had on the Victorian branch of the ALP.
Yeah.
And I wanted to make a couple of quick observations about that. The fact is that in the Victorian ALP, there hasn't been a real pre-selection for more than a decade.
A decade, sir. There are some who argue there hasn't been one since Federation.
Well, I thought that was a bridge too far. That moreover, there hasn't been a serious conference debate on the floor of conference for over a decade, and the conference used to run for several days, several times a year. It's now once a year if they can't put it off until next year. Let me put to you that if Bill Shorten is part of that result, then I think he should be hanging his head in shame.
You are one of many critics who say that the party is too quiet, much, much too quiet. And I would say the same. I would say that the press has a good deal to answer for here, that there should naturally be turmoil inside political parties. That's how policy, that's how...
You're loving the coalition right now then, I'm guessing.
And that a government could be so unbelievably ill-disciplined as the coalition government is one thing, but there is debate going on in there. And I agree with
First you. Cabinet session of the year was a lengthy debate about whether to endorse Kevin Rudd as the Secretary General of the United States. That is even a debate inside a coalition government.
Well, the man who couldn't run Australia was putting himself forward to run the world. And this is, you know, it's a big issue. And Annabel, I think you...
I love that there's an argument about that, though, in a coalition cabinet meeting. I find that very strange.
But there's a problem. There is a problem of the way in which debate inside political parties is reported as collapse, dissent, lack of discipline, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But yes, the unnatural quietness of the Labour Party, and it can't last, can it? I mean, you know, it's going to blow. What
will happen next? So will Turnbull be able to work around the Conservatives and the rise of conservatism in the Senate? Or if the Parliament all falls apart, will Shorten be able to keep his foot on the gas and keep up the policy kind of oomph that he's had? So just like your predictions.
I actually don't think there is a rise of conservatism. I think that the conservatism within the coalition is exactly where it was. I think that it's being accorded a significance which to some degree it doesn't warrant. I mean, one of the things that really puzzled me over the last week, longer than a week, was this sort of resurgence of this idea that we should legislate to change 18C. Now, it seemed to be an issue that wasn't really one during the election campaign. It's certainly not one that Corey Bernardi, no matter how many signatures he gets on his petition, is going to get through the Senate, because enough coalition front benches oppose it, plus the opposition, plus the Greens. It just never get there. But it's this sort of major conflagration. Why? Because there is a sense in which it could be a threat, even though it isn't. It's a strange kind of confidence game politics. And I think one of the interesting things that's happening at the moment is that Malcolm Turnbull, for one of the first times in his life, is losing that confidence game. And that's a very strange thing to witness in a person like that. And one of the reasons for that is that no matter who you are and no matter how confident and how absolutely invincible you were in an early life, as a politician and as a political leader, you learn very deeply from the dreadful things that have happened to you in the past, right? Or as a political leader, you learn from the dreadful things that you've seen happen to other people in the past. And in Malcolm Turnbull's case, he's learned very deeply from 2009, where he overreached and tried to Shanghai his party into this position on climate change that they would not accept. The right wing rose up, overtook him, overbalanced him, and eventually, with the aid of luck, got Tony Abbott elected to the leadership of the party. Now, that ended very badly, as you all know, in the long run. But it's installed a sort of a gremlin in the system, I think, which means that there is a sort of an atavistic apprehension there of the power of that group. Turnbull himself, I think, has made a decision that he's going to lead his party as a group, that he's going to compromise in a way that he didn't before. And the best demonstration of that is his decision, after becoming the leader again of the Liberal Party and becoming the Prime Minister, to sit down with the National Party and sign an agreement that entrenched the position on gay marriage and all sorts of other issues.
Sign an agreement. Sign it.
And once you sign it, well, it's very tricky to get out of that sort of stuff, as Tony Abbott once memorably remarked on 7:30.
But we're not going to be terribly enthusiastic up here about making kind of too many predictions about the future, because we just don't know what events are going to happen. Remember what Macmillan said when asked, you know, what's the main thing about, you know, politicians or something, and his famous reply: "Events, dear boy, events." And let's see how Malcolm Turnbull responds to events. On Shorten, I think there is no sign whatever that his position is anything other than absolutely secure within the Labour Party. I mean, not even the Murdoch press is seriously talking about threats to the Shorten leadership. It's extraordinarily secure within the Labour Party, even those who dislike him and those who fear that he's suppressed true debate within the party regard him as having led a triumphant sort of resurgence of the party. Now, up the top there, Are you there? Have you got a microphone?
The Sherpas.
Can we hear you from up there?
I was just wondering to what extent you think that the sort of policy malaise in Australian politics is due to parties electing combatants. So Kevin Rudd was ideally suited to take on John Howard. Tony Abbott, despite having a smidgen of the talent, was ideally suited to taking on Julia Gillard.
Brilliant. Are we absolutely brilliant?
Are we creating combatants rather than?
No, you've got to have combatants. Policy. I mean, they've got to be able to fight. I mean, the thing is about a political leader, they've got to be able to do a lot of things, not just one or two things. They've got to be fabulous fighters. They've got to think. They've got to be recruiters. They've got to be able to win the loyalty of their followers. They've got to have some intelligence. They've got to have, a lot of things. And one of the problems we've had in political life lately is that we've had a number of politicians who are unbelievably good at a few things, but they haven't got a broad range of talents to actually bed down their leadership and become, for any length of period, any length of time, the leaders of the country. I mean, Gillard was a woman of extraordinary capacities. Her leadership of Parliament and her ability to govern while in a minority will be looked back on as one of the remarkable political periods of this country's history. But she lacked other things. Abbott lacked what we... Well, Abbott, despite my beautiful quarterly essay on him, Abbott, frankly, just turned out to be weird. And Malcolm Turnbull, who is so encouraging in so many ways, has this strange question mark over him about whether he can actually persuade. Is he capable of persuading? Can he make people follow him? Which I think is the big question about him. As a barrister, he could beat his way to victory. He could get pre-selection for his seat by, buying enough. He even invested in his own victory in the last election with huge amounts of money, which is on the one hand kind of commendable and on the other hand creepy. But can he, Annabel, is he able to persuade?
Well, not really on current evidence. I mean, is the hard truth of it, right? I mean, he has started as Prime Minister with this extraordinary reserve of goodwill, not only in the population, but also in the other tiers of government around him. And he's managed to estrange an enormous amount of that in a short time. And I think one of the most reverberant lessons that the experience of the last 6 months tells us is something that really has been on show for the last few elections, which is, you should always go to an election being yourself and believing in the things that you believe in and advocating that way. It's very tricky when you present a mixed message. Mm. And one of the great blunders that was made in the defenestration of Kevin Rudd from the prime ministership of this country in 2010 was that while great attention was paid to opinion polls and to who was struggling and to who was winning the fight on the mining tax, precious little attention was paid to the broader existential question of what populations think of politicians who suddenly stop believing in things. And the reversal of direction of the Rudd government on climate change was a really significant turning point in the ability of this country's capacity to believe in its leaders, And the other thing that I think is going on in this country is that we've forgotten how to be poor.
How do you mean?
I mean that when the terms of trade suddenly went zip in at around about the turn of the century and you had this government, the Howard government, who year after year were getting these extraordinary windfalls from company tax.
Pissed it up against the wall.
Well, no, the political task then became not how do I sort out and respond to what should be the seminal challenge of any political leader, which is how do you accept, convince a group of people to accept a short-term hardship in the interests of mid to long-term prosperity? How do you convince a group of people to cut their cloth in a certain way in order to achieve a better result in the long term? It became an issue of how to spend this extra money. Like, where do we bury this lucre, you know? And over the subsequent 10 years, which were 10 very prosperous years, I think the capacity of the political establishment to respond in a way that was typical of political operatives in the earlier generations really kind of ebbed away. I don't think we're back there yet. How do you sell a hard message to people and match your demands that people undertake hard changes in their own lives with preparedness to put your own ass on the line? You know, that is a great skill in politics, which I think has lain fallow for a long time.
And the label is the 2014 budget.
Right.
Yeah. Look, austerity is something that the poor are used to and can be expected to have lots more of. And what is completely incomprehensible is a call for prosperous people like me to pay tax on their superannuation income. I mean, it's just outrageous. I mean, surely I don't have to argue for the benefits of young people working hard to pay tax that I don't pay. And that seems to me to be the collapse of politics in this country is around those communists who are beginning to talk in terms of, you know, making mining companies pay excise on diesel. I mean, why? I mean, and rich people pay just a tiny little bit of duty when their parents die and give them millions. Why? I mean, that's just outrageous. And really and honestly, capital gains tax should not be paid at the same rate as ordinary taxation, because I won't make as much money in that way, and neither will you, of course. She's a major investor in a number of Australia's blue stock companies. And austerity, I just disagree with you. I think it's a matter of who has to be austere. And I think the traditional austerity of the working class and the poor needs to be reasserted strongly in Australia. And thank heavens we have the Murdoch press to argue for it. And Tony Abbott in his 2014 budget, and let's face it, the principal political task of this country, quite seriously, remains, it appears, passing the 2014 budget. Because that is the principal challenge.
And the 2015 budget.
And the 2015, they're the principal challenges of the Turnbull government. Now look, I have to tell you about a strange psychic experience that we are having up on the stage here. There's a red light flashing.
Yeah, I know,
there.
It's been flashing for ages.
It's been flashing actually for some time. And the staff of the Wheeler Centre are moving up and down in the wings in a kind of arrestive dance.
It's like after the Lincoln assassination. Yeah. There's a lot of anxiety going on in the wings.
And we're taking that to mean we should stop.
I think that's probably the message,
That should... Do you think we should stop?
Well, I don't, obviously, but... But I fear that we're about to be picked off.
But I think we should stop, yes.
Visit wheelercentre.com for the best in books, writing and ideas from Melbourne, Australia and the world.